actually in my own neighborhood that I wasn't aware of. So hopefully you at home and those folks who are here at Kids Kitchen in Henderson are learning a lot too. Now folks, you still have some time. We'll be doing some couple more rounds of interviews going on, and Veterans in Politics International has a show on www.dbtv.com. It's called Veterans in Politics. A lot of the people who have been interviewed here today have been on past shows. If you log on, to see archives of all of the shows. Steve Sanson is sort of the ringleader of this group. He's president of VIPI, and he has gotten quite a few people in to answer some really, really tough questions. So if you missed some of the interviews we did earlier today, you probably can see many of those candidates on previous shows again. That is on www.dbtv.com, Veterans in Politics. We now move on to
just so you know, I'm in your district, I'm in Ward 3. We're being live streamed to everyone like in our ward, just so you know. So speak loudly so they can hear you on the phone.
Keep the microphone up close to your mouth as possible. Right. Joining us now, Tom Collins, a former Clark County Commissioner. He's now running for North Las Vegas City Council Ward 3. Wilson Will Crespo, a retired lieutenant with the North Las Vegas Police Department. We were expecting one more candidate who may show up, and we'll have to take a quick vote on him, who is Ender Austin III, but right now he's not there. But I know I've heard from these two gentlemen on previous interviews on all sorts of other different platforms, and I can tell they will definitely fill the time that we have allotted for their questions. That's not going to be an issue. If you can both start, gentlemen, with giving us a brief bio of yourself and why you're here, we'll start with Mr. Collins.
Thank you, Ricky. Tom Collins. Been here since 1951 in Southern Nevada. I've lived in North Las Vegas over half of my life. I served on the Planning Commission in North Las Vegas 7 years, state legislature 5 terms, and I was elected to the County Commission 3 times. And it's a family matter to take care of in Texas with my dad's stepmom. And I got my mother to move to Tulsa, Oklahoma after her last husband died, and now she lives in the state. She stayed with me a couple months before that. Getting relocated. It's been a few years of process of getting them relocated. They're safe and secure. My dad and stepmom are close to medical facilities, living with my younger sister. And my mom is a go-getter at 86, so she's just about a mile away from me. So I've got the availability and experience to get back in the game.
Mr. Crespo.
My name is Will Crespo. I was raised in the projects in Newark, New Jersey. I found the Air Force as my way out. So I joined the Air Force in 1985 and served honorably to 1989. The following year, I joined the North Las Vegas Police Department in 1990, where I had the privilege to serve my community for 25 years. I also served on our union board as a vice president. I had several jobs on the police department. I was a dare officer, bicycle officer, narcotics officer. I promoted to sergeant. I was also in charge of our community services division at one time. I retired as a lieutenant 2 years ago. I have an 8-year-old daughter. I've been married for 10 years. I also have an 18-year-old son. And I'm looking forward to making North Las Vegas a lot safer, a lot better, and improve and increase our economic development.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Which one of our panelists would like to start? Mr. Patera, Tim Patera.
So, as you know, I'm in your district. I am a constituent, so I want it to be fully known as my job as the state chapter president. I personally invited Steve Black to this endorsement interview. Obviously, he's not here, so I want it on record that I personally invited him. So thank you for showing up. That is one thing in my book that I look forward to show up. Okay, that's awesome. Step one. Here's step to your question. As your constituent, one of my major problems is that our city doesn't have an identity. We are simply Diet Las Vegas. What are you going to do as my councilman to make sure when I tell people I live in North Las Vegas, oh, you live in Vegas. No, I live in North Las Vegas. What is your vision for my city? Whoever wants to.
Well, I have several visions, but I want to initially start by lowering crime. I believe that when we get crime down, that's going to want businesses to come into our city, and people will feel safe in coming into our city to do business. Also, I want to create I want to start with real public service announcements to show that we're moving in the right direction when we start bringing crime down. One of the important things in our city is that I want to show our constituents that we're not only about big major projects, but we care about the little people, us, that we want to improve everyone's quality of life today. So how do we do that? We make sure that we have the resources and the personnel within our city to go and provide those resources, such as better streets, keeping our lights on, keeping the streets clean, keeping our streets smooth, ensuring that we have safe parks. And then also another thing that I would like to do is, why are we the only ones that don't have a major shopping area, like a Summerlin or a downtown Summerlin or a district? We should have areas like that also within our city and in our ward.
Mr. Collins.
Thank you.
Have you used the microphone, Mr. Crespo?
Yeah. Okay.
Louder.
It's louder.
Okay, good.
Thank you. Can you hear me now?
Yes,
you're good. Back in the 80s, if you recall, maybe late 80s, North Las Vegas was proposing to change the name to, I believe it was Vegas Verde. Do you remember that one? We was quite young. And there was attempts to find that identity. North Las Vegas, since its inception, charter, has been a revolving up and down economy. They bought and sold the North Las Vegas Airport 3 times. The last time, they couldn't afford to buy it, so Clark County bought it in order to keep it open because it's the second largest airport in the state of Nevada, second busiest. And Will and I concur on a lot of those things about safer streets. In fact, there was a tax override in our city for safer streets. We've got to find more ways to develop recreation for our youth, activities for them. Making the place safer means more police, more fire, and more involvement out in those communities. You know, recreation centers, a few years ago the city was going to close them. I went to the meeting, told them they couldn't because those recreation centers were funded and built by Clark County and they would have to turn them over to the county. So they kept them open with restricted hours for a while until they got to get a little better back then. There's so much missed opportunity that's been going on in North Las Vegas. I'm a cowboy, so I'll tell you, one of my pet peeves is the fact you can't have a rodeo or a team rope and you can't cowboy up in North Las Vegas. Now, finally, after this 4 years plus, an ordinance was introduced Wednesday night to address that. And the Hispanic community has been spending a lot of time with that, as well as a lot of old-timers that have livestock out in the Ward 3 portion of North Las Vegas. There's so many more things that can be done out there. Promote tourism. For many years, I've promoted functions at the Clark County Shooting Complex at Jason Valiani. And even this weekend, there's a large hunter group out there this weekend. So it's bringing room taxes. One of the things that I think has been lacking, and I've presented that in the past, is tourism. I've approached our elected leaders and said, why isn't there hotels next to Jerry's Nugget or the Silver Nugget or the Poker Palace? Why isn't there more accommodations? And there's been mentioned lately about the Lake Mead Lake Mead I-15 interchange. Well, if you remember, almost 30 years ago, the city started a beautification fund. I heard that from the last speaker, or the last previous interviews. There was a beautification fund passed, in the 90s for 25 cents every month on your water bill. I think it's at 75 cents now. So there's got to be a commitment to our neighborhood and find the vehicles to promote it. Building a lot of warehouses and so forth brings things, but the tax abatements they get really doesn't help the bottom line of the city.
All right, we're going to move on to our next question from Craig. Oops, maybe not. Feedback.
Maybe not, Craig.
Start with a bang.
Right.
Both of you have been involved in a number of different facets in your community, being in North Las Vegas for a long time. What are the two things that you think North Las Vegas has done wrong in the last couple of years?
Start with Mr. Collins.
Going negative kind of early. I think some of it has just been inaction.
by focusing on a budget versus regional efforts to improve things, meaning working with the police. Closing the jail, terrible mistake. Open that jail back up, you bring thousands of hours of police officers back into the city. Instead of them spending so much time going over to the Las Vegas City Jail, paying a lot of money to be there, waiting in line, and they're not in the city where they serve. So that'd be one. The other big mistake recently, I think, is canceling the municipal court to go down to one court. And then yesterday's reports were that their revenue is up because of grants, fines, fees, and forfeitures. Well, with only one judge instead of two, you're giving us less chance. With two judges, you've got more time to bring people in and correct the situations going on. But under my conspiracy thoughts, since we're talking that way, if you don't have an election for a municipal judge, and then you do your budget May through July, and then adjust it in August for state law, then you go back and say, you know, we need a judge, let's appoint one, and then we get to pick another puppet. So that's kind of negative, I'm sorry.
Mr. Crespo?
I believe we weren't as responsible. The city wasn't as responsible as it could have been with the money it already had. We paid the highest taxes per capita in our city, in Nevada. I know because the houses I've lived in, they've only been in North Las Vegas. I lived in El Dorado, now I live in Aliante, and we pay the highest taxes, and we pay those taxes for a reason. We expect services. Well, when you cut the workforce by over 50%, you're gonna lose services. And enough of this, we can do more with less. No, you can't. What happens is when you have less, you're gonna get less, period. You're gonna burn your people out, you're gonna burn the workforce out. We ended up building a monstrosity of a city hall at a time when we didn't need it, and that cost us. The water reclamation plan, that cost us. So now those bonds are coming due, and now we're having to figure out how we're gonna balance the budget because we decided to, what I consider make poor, not only business decisions, but fiscal decisions.
Our next panelist, Rob Lauer.
I'm actually very familiar with North Las Vegas. My company actually managed and owned a lot of real estate. And we actually owned a shopping center for about a year and a half on Las Vegas Boulevard. And it was like freaking Iraq. There was so much violence and crime there, I couldn't tell you. I got calls at 2 in the morning that somebody was shot. I had a guy drive a pickup truck through the front window of the cell phone company store there, stole all the cell phones. It was just nonstop violence and crime. And so it's hard to get people to invest. It's hard to get big companies to come in and invest in those shopping centers and provide jobs. We had rental properties that people were breaking into and stealing all the pipes out of the houses and the air conditioners off the roofs. Unless you fix crime, we're not going to invest in it. We sold our properties. We're out. You're not going to get our companies and other people like us to bring millions of dollars into your city unless you're going to fix crime. What are you going to do to fix crime?
Well, that's the major point of all everything I'm running on. The foundation of what I'm running on is reducing crime. I understand that. I saw it for 25 years. I heard it from business owners like yourself for 25 years. People are afraid. I spoke to a group of doctors recently, and some doctors are in North Las Vegas. Some have their businesses on Martin Luther King near Alexander. And I had a doctor pull me to the side after I spoke to the doctors, and she said, I'm the tough one. I'm willing to have my business in North Las Vegas. But I can assure you that a lot of my colleagues are afraid to have their businesses in North Las Vegas. And that's why I want to show real crime reduction. I know how to do it. I did it for 25 years. When I was in charge of my squad, one of my goals was not to have any homicides west on the west side, west of the 215. So for over a year, we didn't have one gang-related homicide west of the I-15 on the west side of North Las Vegas. Not a one. I know how to stop crime. I know how to make it safer. So what I want to do is when I make it safer, I'm going to let the community know and everyone in this valley know that North Las Vegas is now safer. Bring your businesses in. And not only that, come do business in our city. They're going to be safe. You're not worried about getting robbed, and you don't have to worry about what you said earlier, getting killed.
Mr. Collins?
your question's well stated, and it's been a fact for a long time. Businesses were not, growth doesn't pay for growth, therefore, the number of police, the number of first responders, the parks and rec and the programs for kids to stay out of trouble with, the just creating that family again in North Las Vegas. And several examples, like Will brought out, he's been a fantastic law enforcement man for many years in North Las Vegas. And we're back to when I got on the Planning Commission in the 80s, North Las Vegas had a restricted growth ordinance. And they did that to stop the 235i homes at the federal program before some of y'all were born, I guess. Y'all are very young. But the programs brought in substandard housing, and North Las Vegas, to try to grow, did El Dorado and abandoned Lake Mead, the College Park area. The cities went from College Park, Arrowhead Estates, to El Dorado, to Aliante, now the Village of Tule Springs and Apex. Now, I've broken ground in Apex with four different mayors, and there's still not a lot gotten done. Without these tax abatements and so-called promises, it's still funding programs. For example, Hyperloop, most of Hyperloop is still in Clark County. A couple of the buildings are in North Las Vegas. To your commercial and professional office building locations, the city has done too much, been too involved in approving so much commercial property. It's making it riskier and less affordable, I mean less profitable. And it's the last place to fill up. North Las Vegas is the last place in this valley to fill up without going over the peak to Sloan. So the property's cheaper, you get less results. Now, when I talked about the restricted growth, my years on the Planning Commission through with a consultant group out of Phoenix, we developed a pro-growth community, a development-friendly community. And at the same time, we were passing overrides to support more public safety and law enforcement. So through the years in North Las Vegas, it's just like right now. Like Will said, the Moody's reporting has said it. A New York based said North Las Vegas is short 800 employees. Well, a lot of them are police and fire and public works and infrastructure folks. So when you got those problems, it's a risk. And I've always said, you know, to anybody I could talking about North Las Vegas, we don't have to buy business. We need to provide a good community, a safe community that they want to locate in. Last session of the Nevada legislature, I got a bill passed blocking annexation to unwilling property owners. That's where I go back to an earlier question of quality of life, public safety, and property rights. And the three points that I make for this campaign. Thank you.
Mr. Robert Faust.
Thank you both for being here today. Appreciate it. My question is going to be regarding schools. As city councilman, you're going to have some involvement with the school system out there. And I believe Arborview is in your district, and that's probably one of the worst teacher-student problems that this state has ever had. If you're familiar with it, you read the paper, and the athletic director out there was arrested for pornography, and he was actually using one of the students out there. What would be your plan to discriminate, but to screen teachers better, to screen people better, to make sure things like this aren't happening?
Yeah, I tell you how great I am at that. Hi, Chris Garvey. And I'll tell you why. It's because I've worked with the school district, and as a state legislator, I've worked with state lawmakers, local governments, and the school district to work better on those schools. Arborview is actually way west of North Las Vegas, but there's issues been in North Las Vegas in the schools, and it's a difficult situation. The school district's been mandated so many policies and responsibilities on the state and federal government side of it that they've got a bureaucracy that they're bound by law to deal with before they can rightfully get down and do with the kids and the teachers. Teachers do a background check. That's state law, not local law. Teachers go through certification. That, again, is a state board, not a local board. The school, the local government responsibility for schools is a school site location, okay, as far as it can be just built here, built there, whatever, and then they got to do the sidewalks, streetlights, and all this, you know, infrastructure. So addressing the children's safety goes back to what I mentioned earlier. More recreational and community opportunities and more involvement with the families that live over there instead of trying to be over the mountain and hide from them with some new developments.
Mr. Crespo?
Again, just like most professions that require us to work with children, I know they try to have as extensive a background as possible. I think what is required of us to do now, because obviously there are loopholes that these people are getting through. So what we're going to need to do is get all your experts in those specific areas together to figure out where the loophole is and how we can fix it. So let's get the chiefs of police from like school police, North Las Vegas, the sheriff from Metro, the chief from Henderson, your school administrators, some local leaders, some concerned parents, your political leaders. Let's all get together and let's put a stop to this. Let's all figure out where the loophole is, because I know everybody's gonna fall back on. We do extensive background checks and we can't check for everything. We're missing something somewhere.
So why not go ahead and have ongoing checks? Like every year you have to be certified, or every 2 years.
I like that, because I know in the police department, as police officers, we get background checked every year. So I agree with that. So that's another thing we could do. But let's get the experts involved though. Let's see what else we can look into to see how we can at the very least minimize this. Nothing's ever 100%, I get that, but there's got to be things we could do to even lower those possibilities.
Andre Haynes, our next question.
Thank you, gentlemen, for coming. A spokeswoman for Faraday Future said that company is absolutely not scaling back its operations and will begin work on approximately 650,000 square foot plant at Apex Industrial Park in North Las Vegas. Spokeswoman Dan Z said that the plant is in addition to 3 million square foot plant for which the company intends to begin construction at this year's third and fourth quarter. Nevada Treasurer Dan Swartz said he is even more skeptical of the project now than he was when lawmakers approved $215 million in tax incentives in December 2015. Last October, the general contractor overseeing more than $500 million in construction on the $1 billion project issued a warning to Faraday over an unpaid $21 million deposit that had been due in December. Do you support the approved $215 million in tax incentives in December 2015 for Faraday? Why or why not?
I have a problem with tax abatements. The reason being, you got billion-dollar companies asking for city monies. I have a big issue with that. I think Mark Cuban said it best. He said when owners of sports franchises want tax abatements, here are these billionaires asking cities that need those monies for resources and services, asking them to buy in or help them buy these stadiums that they can easily afford. So I do have concerns. I'm not saying you can't do those and you shouldn't do those. I don't think every company actually needs that incentive to come into your city. You can sell your city in many other ways than just to buy a company to come in. I'm not saying that's what they're doing. I believe that a lot of companies want to come to cities like North Las Vegas. You just got to give them the right sales pitch. Money is not always the right sales pitch. Of course, if you offer anybody money, most of them are going to take it. If you offer me and I'm the owner of a multi-billion dollar company, you offer me $100 million when I really didn't need it, you don't think I'm going to take the $100 million? Of course I'm going to take the $100 million. And I think that's what's happening today. I'm not saying we don't need those types of programs when, let's say, we're competing with another city, or we look at all options, but let's not make that the first option, because those monies that we're giving away could be better used to provide services for our citizens.
Mr. Collins.
Thank you. And I'll go back to what I said earlier. You know, you can't buy business. Growth didn't pay for growth. And these tax abatements are not new. For years,
local government, either the county or the cities, would get a letter approximately once a month from Steve Hill's office, the Government Office of Economic Development. And in those letters would be that the state agreed through that committee or that board that company XYZ was going to get a tax break of a few $100,000, a few $1 million, whatever, based on their commitment to come and build certain size business and hire a certain number of employees and pay a certain amount of wage. Now, we already saw that problem in Tesla up in northern Nevada, because now you've packed Washoe County as well as Burnley and Fallon, and they're down to Yerington and Stagecoach, you know where that is in between all that. Those towns are impacted, their schools, their roads, their infrastructure, and the price of their housing, whether it's purchase or rental, because the prices have jacked up. If you saw this morning's paper, property value is going way up. Property value is not a quality of life. So these tax abatements, when I say they took place before, in the 80s and 90s, Nevada Economic Development gave tax incentives to California companies. They came over, built in Sparks or in Douglas County. The folks that worked there couldn't afford to live in Douglas County. It's always been expensive. So they overburdened Carson City and the schools and the infrastructure and the hospital there. And likewise in southern Nevada, specifically to Faraday, Dan Schwartz, as a Chinese, his wife's from China, he said, he's been over there as a businessman for years, and he knows the business in China and how it works through the government and so forth. So he's made it clear for a long time. Also, the GOED has gone to the legislature to remove those state bonds from part of that special legislation for Faraday. There's a lot of concern about them. And rightly so, because they got a deal in Hyperloop. Hyperloop went straight to the state of Nevada. Faraday came to North Las Vegas. Two different approaches to get the tax abatements. However, at the same time, a lot of the other property owners in the Apex area are now coming and asking for tax abatements, saying, we'll do this if you give us that. Well, there again, if you're giving these folks benefits, instead of being competitive, and that goes back to the legislation about annexation, cities should be competitive to bring in business. And in order to be competitive and bring in business, they also need to be safe and have the programs and the educational system for the kids that you mentioned in the school district. Good enough?
Yeah, that's pretty good. Thank you very much. We have just heard from two candidates for North Las Vegas City Council Ward 3. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us today.
Closing remarks,
really quickly.
If you don't vote for me, vote for Will.
Okay, that was the best one I've heard this morning. Fantastic. Thank you. And Will.
I'm not going to say the same. No, I'm kidding. If you don't vote for me, vote for Tom. But I'm going to make it safer. I know how to make it safer. At the end of the day, your quality of life will improve. Thank you.
Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us this morning. Thank you.